Hi, my name is Cate Crowley from Teachers College here in New York City. Welcome to Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding video tutorials. This is module 1.4, where we're going to talk about velopharyngeal closure and nasoendoscopies.
Let's talk about velopharyngeal closure during speech. So let's say this is the velum. During speech, the velum will move up against the posterior pharyngeal wall. When we close it off like this, then we can produce oral sounds. When it's open, the air will go up and we'll produce nasal sounds.
Here is a nasal endoscopy of the same thing. You can see the velar lift during speech.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Puppy.
Puppy.
Say puffy.
Puppy.
Say pamper.
Pamper.
Say bye, Bobby.
Bye, Bobby and Mummy.
Say sissy sees the sun. Okay, say pop, 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 pop.
So let's talk about the muscles that are involved in velopharyngeal closure. There's the levator veli palatini, and that's the muscle that you need in order for the velum to move up. Then there's the superior pharyngeal constrictors, which those are the muscles that are involved with the medial, with the lateral pharyngeal wall so that they can move inward. Then there's the muscular uvulae, which contracts during phrenation and creates that bulge in the velum. And lastly, there's the palatoglossus muscle, which depresses the velum. There's a tensor veli palatini, and this muscle is not that involved with velopharyngeal closure, but it's a very important muscle. And this muscle is responsible for the opening and closing of the eustachian tubes for middle ear drainage. So it's an important muscle because a lot of children with cleft palate, their hearing may be affected because that muscle is not inserted in the right place. So with a child with a cleft palate, they have all these muscles, but they're not in the right place, and so they're not moving the way they should be. So levator veli palatini is responsible for the velum to move upward and back. So it moves like a sling, up and back. With a child with a cleft palate, the sling didn't fuse, and so it's open. And so the child's not going to have that proper movement in order to achieve velopharyngeal movement closure. So in this picture on the left, you see a child with a cleft soft palate. And on the right, there's a cleft of the hard palate all the way up to the lips. And the levator veli palatini is there, but not in that sling position. So it's sort of like it's cut. And so then the child won't be able to chew that velopharyngeal closure. So when we talk about velopharyngeal closure, it's important to talk about what's going on with the mouth and the nose. And when explaining to a parent, it's easier to explain when we talk about things that they can relate to. So let's talk about the oral cavity, the nasal cavity, and the velum. The oral cavity we can refer to as the first floor, right here. The nasal cavity is the second floor, right here. In between the nasal cavity and the oral cavity, in between the second floor and the first floor, there's a door that opens and closes. For certain sounds, the door stays open, so the air goes all the way up and comes out through the second floor. And for those sounds, like the mm, it's important for that door to stay open. Then sometimes the door has to stay closed for some sounds for the air to come out of the mouth. So if you go pa, ta, ka, s, all the air is coming out of the mouth. And those are oral sounds, and the door remains closed for those. And the door, the green area, the velum, has to move up and back towards the velopharyngeal wall. And when that happens, there are different types of closures that occur. So there's a coronal closure, which you see in the first diagram, where there's a lot of movement of the soft palate, or the velum, in order to achieve that closure. There's little movement of the lateral pharyngeal walls. Then there's a sagittal closure, where there is more movement of the lateral pharyngeal walls and little movement of the soft palate, the velum, and the posterior pharyngeal wall. Then there's a circular pattern, where all the areas are involved in closure. And lastly, there's circular closure that goes against the passavent's ridge. So the passavent's ridge is this dynamic structure that is in the posterior pharyngeal wall that occurs when you phonate and you swallow. And so with this closure, it goes against the passavent's ridge. How do we see velopharyngeal closure? You need to conduct a nasopharyngoscopy to see it occur. You'll see the posterior pharyngeal wall move forward. Then these lateral pharyngeal walls, you'll see them moving medially. And the soft palate will move back and up. to achieve that closure.
Here you can see good velopharyngeal closure.
Pa, 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 pa.
Good, once more, just like that.
Pa, 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 pa.
Count from 1 to 10.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
In this nasal endoscopy, we see a child who is physically incapable of closing his velum due to scarring from his cleft palate. He has good lateral wall movement but can never close in the center. This is a surgical problem.
Say puppy.
Puppy.
Say puffy.
Puppy.
Say pamper.
Pamper.
Say bye, Bobby. A
bye, Bobby, and puppy.
Say sissy sees the sun. Okay, say pop, 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 pop. Can you say pa, pa, pa?
Pa, pa, pa.
Puppy.
Puppy.
Puffy.
Puffy.
Pamper.
Pamper.
Bye, Bobby, a puppy.
Bye, Bobby, a puppy.
Sissy sees the sun.
Sissy sees the sun.
Okay, make that T. Okay.
So what is velopharyngeal dysfunction? Well, velopharyngeal dysfunction could be velopharyngeal insufficiency, of velopharyngeal incompetency. So when we talk about velar insufficiency, that refers to the structural issues involved. So that might be because there's a tissue anatomical deficit, or maybe the velum's too short and can't close the valve. So it's more of a structural organic issue. Then with velopharyngeal incompetency, that refers to the functional part of it, the movement area. So there may be a neurological or physiological issue involved that does not allow for velopharyngeal closure. Maybe the tissue doesn't move enough. Maybe there's apraxia, so it does not coordinate at the right times. It may be related to ALS, dysarthria, brainstem tumor, stroke, or TBI.
Vivi ve al bebé.
Vivi ve al bebé. Vivi ve al bebé. Vivi ve al bebé.
So we looked at velopharyngeal closure not occurring because of structural reason or physiological reason. Now let's talk about mislearning. So with velopharyngeal mislearning results in an articulation disorder that seems like velopharyngeal dysfunction, but the structure is normal and the function is normal.
This concludes Module 1.4 of Module 1 of Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding Video Tutorials. If you didn't see all of the modules yet, you can find them all at leadersproject.org. Next module, we will talk about how cleft palate can affect speech.